winner at 19, Scott Mitchell. That was his number, and he joins us here. He's my broadcast partner on Utah Game Days. When last we were together, it wasn't such a good day for Utah football. They finished the season with the loss in the Alamo Bowl. I still have people a week later, Scott, asking me what happened.
What happened? We got our butts handed to us. That's what happened.
Yeah, one team showed. I tell people, one, there's no easy answer, but the easy answer, if you want one, is one team showed up to play, the other one didn't.
I have to believe that it's just hard. It's hard when you have such a letdown. I mean, you're talking college football playoffs. You're talking the Rose Bowl. These are big-time events in college football. I mean, the events in college football. And to know that if you win, you're in, either one. And so that's a hard pill to swallow. And you look at, you know, we talked about teams losing the Pac-12 championship. Just losing that, have gone 0 for 10 now in bowl games. So it's a hard emotional adjustment. It's kind of the time of year when, you know, it's like, all right, this is our reward. Let's kind of take a break. And that's not typically been the way that Kyle Whittingham and Utah's approach bowl games, but it felt like this was the way they approached this one. Showed up early, got on a lot of roller coasters, had a good time, and didn't really have that kind of energy and focus for a football game.
You and I both kind of looked at each other when Tyler Huntley said in the post-game press conference, we treated it more like a vacation than a business trip, didn't we?
Yeah, that was a huge surprise with just the attitude this team and the focus it's had all year to kind of admit to that kind of attitude.
Scott Mitchell's our guest, my broadcast partner, one of the great Utah quarterbacks of all time. So I asked, obviously there's going to be a lot of holes. We found out Friday the entire secondary is going to have to be replaced. Javelin Guidry put his name in for the NFL draft. So three corner spots and two safety spots will have to be replaced, a linebacking spot, a couple of tackles, an end. Your quarterback, your left tackle, your starting running back are all going to have to be replaced. Now, the one thing we do know is they've recruited very well. There's a ton of talent in the program, but it's going to be new and inexperienced talent in some certain places. If I ask you to give me one player, Scotty, one player whose production and impact will be the most difficult to replace, who would you go with?
Well, there could be a lot of people, but I'm going to say Julian Blackman.
That's who I went with too. That's who I went with too.
And the reason is between these two quarterbacks, it looks like one of them could really emerge. There's a lot of talent still at running back. There's a lot of talent still on the line. In fact, Utah had quite a young offensive line last year. Looking at it, and so they'll be more experienced. The defensive line, there are guys in the pipeline. There is one linebacker, Devin Lloyd, who the other one, you know, at least there's one, but there's nobody in the secondary. I mean, no one. And so that's going to be a tall order because somebody, you know, Julian Blackman was so good at, and Utah was so good at mixing their coverages and their looks, and they were so tough against both the pass and the run. It's a lot to ask your team to kind of replace. You look at Washington this past year, and they replaced nine guys on defense, and you could see it had an impact. Even though those guys are talented, they're young and they're inexperienced, and there's just a growth and a learning curve, and that usually means two, maybe three losses on the year because of just that inexperience.
No, I completely agree with you. I think that while Tyler Huntley and Zach Moss both had great seasons, I don't think one guy replaces Moss's production, but I think you've got a trio or three or four good running backs that can put up the numbers that Zach put up, and you could be fine. And I really do believe as accurate and as good as Tyler was, and we saw a lot of improvement in his game, that these guys coming in could be as good or better. And I think you and I talked about it down in San Antonio. It wouldn't surprise me at all if Utah kind of shifted the way it played a little bit offensively next year. And while they were kind of a 60-40 run-to-pass team this year, it wouldn't surprise me next year with one of those big-armed quarterbacks and all those wide receivers, not a proven bell cow tailback, maybe they're more 60-40 pass to run.
Yeah, I think the thing Andy Ludwig has done the very best, and he'll admit this, is he's going to play to the strength of the players he has. Brian Thompson can be an elite receiver in the Pac-12. Brant Keithy can be an elite player in the Pac-12. Jalen Dixon has elite speed, although his size is, you know, he's undersized, but he's just got crazy speed. Covey comes back to full strength. Those are four serious weapons you have offensively, and you have these quarterbacks that are probably more inclined to, like you said, throw the ball. So it'd be interesting to see how they get the ball in these playmakers' hands next season. And on top of the running backs, I mean, I still think there's a lot of talent at running back on Utah. So offensively, the team could be very different, probably will be, but still, I think, can be extremely explosive.
Scotty,
it may have to be.
Yeah, well, I think it will have to be. I think the offense may have to carry, you know, for so many years, the defense has carried the load. And even this year, when the offense was markedly better, the defense was elite. Next year might be a year where maybe you're not holding opponents to 12 and 13 points a game. Maybe you're giving up 17, 18, 20 points a game. Your offense may have to carry a little bit more of the load next year.
And that may be a good thing, because I think Utah had a hard time competing in a game where they had to compete. When USC was kind of, it was back and forth, and they just didn't answer well when they had to change momentum and they had to answer back to the success of another team. And Oregon kind of showed the same thing. And I mean, they did it against Washington, but I don't know how good Washington really was. And then of course in the bowl game, they just weren't competing. And sometimes when you have to play hard, you know, it's a back and forth game, and it comes down to a last score. That experience and that confidence you gain to know, hey, I can pull out a win here late, and in a pressure situation, that really, I think, helps you when you get down and you get in those big games when all of a sudden every snap, every play becomes that much more magnified.
All right, let's talk for a minute about the quarterbacks, because that's the position that you know better than anybody. That's the quarterback position. It's not going to be Tyler Huntley. It's not going to be Jason Shelley. It's not going to be Drew Lisk. We can eliminate those guys. It's going to be one of two guys. It's going to be Jake Bentley, or it's going to be Cam Rising. Two former four-star players. Cam Rising's never taken a college snap, and Jake Bentley has never played in this Utah system, but he started for 2.5 years. Would have been 3 years had he not hurt his foot last year. He is coming off a little bit of a foot injury, but he's here. He's in town. He's in class. He's enrolled and with the team now. So is the advantage to Cam Rising, having been in the program for a year and knowing the personnel and knowing his teammates and knowing the system, or is the advantage to Jake Bentley, having played real bona fide SEC college football for 2 years, Scott?
So I don't know the answer to this, but I would be curious to find out if Utah pursued Jake Bentley or if he just came here on his own accord. And I'd be curious to know that, because they've had a lot of time to watch Cam Rising and see kind of what he is and who he is. And the things that I've heard about him, I've watched him a little bit. I liked him before. But I've heard really good things: arm strength, leadership, dynamic player, person. He seems like a guy that can lead you into battle, a lot like Tyler Huntley was. And because if they've watched him and watched him practice, maybe there's a question mark if he's really ready. And where Andy Ludwig's been in the SEC for a couple of years at Vanderbilt, he's been able to watch Jake Bentley play.
Andy recruited him to Vanderbilt.
Yeah, and so he knows him well,
yep.
Right? And what Andy's, you know, so I don't know those answers, but maybe that is part of the answer. So maybe he's like, I have a lot of confidence in this guy and what he can do and what I can do with him and the kind of talent we have around us. And so he's a guy I can really mold. I think Jake Bentley, because it's just 1 year, he's got to be like head and shoulders above Cam Rising, because if you feel like, look, we can win now, we can get back to the Pac-12 championship with this guy this year, and it's kind of a one, you know, it's a hired gun, so to speak, then they probably go with Bentley. But if it's like, okay, next year is going to be a little bit of a retooling year, and we want experience. We want Cam Rising to get experience, kind of like what they did with Tyler Huntley, where he hadn't been the starter the year before, and he was in this competition and beat out the senior, and you kind of take a lump for a year or so, but it pays big dividends in the end. So that's where I think it kind of boils down. I don't know who the better one is, but obviously you got a guy that's proven in a tough conference, and you got a guy with a lot of potential. I don't think you're going to go wrong. You know, somebody's going to emerge from that as probably a really good, maybe one of the top tier quarterbacks in the conference next year, because you've got some guys, you know, moving on. I mean, obviously Slovis and JT or Jaden Daniels at Arizona State, and, you know, JT Dan, I don't know where he goes or what he does, but Utah have a really good quarterback next year, which you need to have.
Well, you got to have two good quarterbacks. I mean, I think we found that out. You've got to have one that's a starter and one that's ready to go behind him in college football today. Look at Alabama and some other places. But here's what I would say. I haven't talked to Andy Ludwig. Andy and I talk on a regular basis. I've not talked to him yet because he didn't want to talk about any of this during the season. The next time I see him, I'll kind of – we'll have a conversation about, you know, how you're going to handle this. But here's what I would say. You played the position much more than me, but I've covered it for 25 years. I always, whether it's in quarterback play or in life, I give the edge to somebody that's got real experience in doing it and real experience at a high level. And Jake Bentley has that. He's been throwing passes against Georgia and Alabama and Auburn and LSU. He threw for 504 tugs against Clemson. Name me the last. Joe Burrow may do that next Monday night, but there haven't been many people in the last 7 years that have thrown for five Bills and four touchdowns on Clemson. So this kid can spin the football. Cam Rising, I know, has been in the system, but here's the other thing. Cam's got 3 years to play. Jake Bentley's got 1 year to play. Jake's got experience. You can still get Cam in there. He's got four games. You know, he's got as many games as you want him to play. You can get him in here and there. But to me, as I'm looking at it and handicapping it from the outside before spring practice, my lean would be toward Jake Bentley based on the experience and what Cam – I mean, is there anything wrong with Cam Rising playing a little bit this year and then being a starter for 2 years? Probably not. So – if I was looking at it, and again, I've not talked to Andy about it, that's just how I would size it up from the outside.
Yeah, it appears there's a relationship. There's a, like, there's an, you know, whether he watched him play or recruited him, you know, for, you know, to play quarterback, you know, there's got to be something, some kind of connection there. And so, and your point about two is good, because this offensive line last year had some holes in it, and Tyler Huntley was amazing at escaping, you know, so off he got sacked enough, but these guys, I don't know if they're as athletic or mobile as they may take shots, you know, unless they mess up in a year. And so these guys get, you very well could see both guys play throughout the year.
Catch my partner each and every weeknight from 7 until 9 o'clock on KSL with his partner, Alex Keery, and catch him for the next time on a broadcast with me during spring football. Right, Scott?
You know it.
We'll check our calendars a week or two in advance. Hey, thanks for coming on. I'll talk to you soon.
Yeah, always. Thank you.